In this episode of Youth Work Toolbox, we speak to Ray Douglas, anti-youth violence specialist and core facilitator at Gangology UK.
Centre-based or detached, planned or improvised, paid or voluntary, however you work with young people, this is the show for you. Welcome to Youth Work Toolbox with Tony Brown, where it's all about equipping one generation to serve the next. Team Toolbox, let's go.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Youth Work Toolbox with me, Tony Brown. And whether you've been working with young people for 2 decades, 2 years or 2 weeks, we can all improve our practice in one way or another and take youth provision to the next level. And as you know, Team Toolbox, that's exactly what we're all about here. It's all about equipping one generation to serve the next. And like I said, I don't care how long you've been working with young people, we can all improve our practice in one way or another. I've been doing this thing now for almost 20 years. And every day I learn something new. Every interview, I learn something new. Every book I read, I learn something new inside and outside of the youth sector. So I encourage you guys, just keep learning, keep growing and keep challenging yourselves. We can all improve our practice in one way or another. So I've got a great interview for you today. As you heard in the intro, we've got Ray Douglas on the show. Ray's from Gangology UK. And this interview, when I listen back to it, during the editing process, there's so much in there, so much to take from it. Ray's approach to facilitating workshops, his approach to addressing some of the issues that we've been facing in the youth culture in the UK. He's very much ahead of his game and he's very much a sector leader, I would say, in this field. So you're really going to want to get your pen and pad and or your Evernote, whatever you use, and listen keenly and closely to what Ray shares with us. I've found it really encouraging and empowering and informative. So we're going to want to dive straight into that. But before we do, I just want to give you a few updates. Recently, I was given an opportunity to speak at this year's Hay Festival. For those of you that haven't heard of the Hay Festival, it takes place every year in the UK between May and June. And what it is, it's a gathering of writers, thinkers, filmmakers, historians, novelists, philosophers, poets, etc. And it's a little bit like a TED conference. It's been called the Woodstock of the mind. And basically it runs over a period of a week and people share their thoughts, people share their works. Again, there's authors there, poets, filmmakers, etc. And I was given an opportunity to speak at this event. I have to say, it was a great experience and I was a little bit taken aback with the invite, but I had an opportunity to stand and to share my entrance into youth work. I told my story about how I was given an opportunity and that opened up many doors for me to enter into youth work. And then just really went on to share about the positive impact youth work had on me and on my life and the benefits of that. And by the end of the talk, I could see many of the audience members were really inspired, but also they were taken aback when I shared about the challenges facing the youth sector, the cuts within services, the loss of youth services across the country. I could see people were really taken aback. And what I saw was that we really need to raise the awareness of the current challenges that the youth sector is facing because people don't know about it. I asked the audience, it was quite a large audience, and I asked them to put their hand up if they engaged in or attended youth provision as a young person. And many of them put their hands up. And then I started to give examples. So, you know, did you go to scouts, to Cubs? Did you attend a structured sports club? Did you go to Sunday school, whatever it might be? And by the end of that, almost every person put their hand up. And I says to them, you know, what impact did that have on you? Just think about the positive impact attending that provision had on you. And I could see a lot of them were sort of thinking and smiles came to their faces. Many of them were nodding their heads like to say, yeah, it really did have a positive impact. And I says, well, a lot of these young people today, unfortunately, are not going to have access to that provision because of these cuts, and we need to do something about it. And one audience member put his hand up and started to talk about, he shared his thoughts and a few comments, and he was talking about just the fact that the service or the youth sector is not in the spotlight. And he was saying, look at shows like Casualty, Holby City, The Bill, you know, these are public services that they're making programs about and they're in the public eye and are really seen as valuable services. And we spoke about reality TV shows such as Educating Yorkshire and those other ones. And it really shines a light on the services provided within that sector. And it really got me thinking, you know, we really need to shout about what youth work does, the impact of youth work, the power of youth work, the importance of youth work. So I encourage you guys, any opportunity you get, you know, phone your local radio station, send stories to your local newspaper, any good news stories, just send them. Obviously, the press, they've got an obligation every single day to fill their newspapers. So if you've got any good news stories, just keep sending them off to them. You know, like I said, phone the radio station and contribute to the talks and you know, really raise the awareness of the value and the importance of youth provision. And it's not always about, you know, lobbying to say, you know, save our youth service, but just to plant the seed in people's minds. Because like I said, a lot of those in the audience, they didn't realise the pressures facing the youth service. So I encourage you, like I said, it was a great opportunity for me to speak at the Hay Festival and to really raise that awareness. And I encourage you to do the same. Any opportunity you get to speak, any opportunity you get to share about the value of youth work, just take it. Share a story, share a case study, share your experience. What has youth work done for you? Because people, they just don't know. Also, just wanted to update you on a few things here at Youth Work Toolbox. If you go over to the website, you'll see that there's a new tab appeared on the navigation bar, which says clothing. And if you click that, you will see our new t-shirt range. And we've got a number of designs that we're potentially going to be putting out. But as part of the initial launch, we're just focusing on the one design, which is equipping one generation to serve the next. And it's a bold statement. And it's, like I said, it's my tagline. And it says a lot. And what I want us to do is to use this statement on this t-shirt, again, to really help raise awareness and to get people to really join this movement. You know, we've got a responsibility to equip this generation coming up. These young people are our future leaders. And again, I know Team Toolbox, I'm probably preaching to the converted. You're all, if you're listening to this, then you've obviously got a vested interest in the youth sector. So forgive me, but I'm really passionate. We've got a responsibility to equip these young people because they're our future leaders, future business owners, future educators, and they need guidance. They need people to come alongside them and to really equip them to embrace and take on the challenge or challenges that await them. So it's all about equipping one generation to serve the next, as I said. So if you really believe that and you want to support and join this movement, then feel free, grab yourself a t-shirt, wear it when you're working with young people, wear it when you're out and about, and let people know we're serious about this. It's all about equipping one generation to serve the next. We're not just playing pool and table tennis. We're not just kicking a ball around. We're equipping a generation for the future. So go and check it out, youthworktoolbox.com/clothing, and you can grab your Equipping One Generation t-shirt today. But without further ado, like I said, I've got a real valuable interview. So let's get straight into it and invite Ray Douglas to the show. Okay, Team Toolbox, it's my pleasure to welcome Ray Douglas to the show. Ray is the core facilitator at the National Anti-Youth Violence Programme, which is a not-for-profit organisation that deliver hard-hitting workshops that were developed in response to the rise in gang culture and violence within the youth culture in the UK. They deliver a range of workshops to schools, youth offending teams, youth services and those within the voluntary and community sector. He also leads on the Gangology strand, which again is related to the anti-youth violence stream. And he's also currently authoring two books related to youth violence and gang culture. And we're going to talk a lot more about that in this interview. So, Ray, it's great to have you on the show. I've just given our audience a very brief overview into who you are. But just take a minute and just give us a bit more of insight into who you are, what you do and how you started out.
Okay, good morning, Tony, and thank you for inviting me on the podcast. My journey, like many people listening in or yourself, started off with a passion to work and from a probably a peer-led perspective in the youth sector.
Yeah.
So my first kind of paid work was at 16 when I left school, and what was my youth worker saw something in me and offered me a summer job. I mean, at the time, I think you're talking, I'll show my age here, talking 1990, and it was probably a 30-hour post a week. And those, there was no direct debit there, no chip and pin. It was in a brown envelope.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a great, even till today, I still see this, occasionally see this gentleman. And he was the one who opened the door for me. So at 16, it was my first interest. So, but when I'm looking back on it, it was more like a peer-led approach, which was really good. I don't know if it, actually, I don't know if he did reverse psychology to keep me out of trouble either, but I'll ask him that next time I see him. And then I went on to volunteer, which was a place called Osmanaz, which was Bernardo's run. Okay. And once again, introduced and met some great people who even today, who now they're my peers in the sense that I work in the same field as them, but then they were my youth workers. And that opened up my eyes to a lot of opportunity. At the latter part of that, then, I kind of went into a journey, a personal journey, a journey looking at the inner game, spirituality, you know, seeking purpose. So kind of, I did step away from youth work, but I was kind of, that was the next part of my journey, because I forgot to mention that at 17, 18, I was actually a signed recording artist.
Okay.
At a very young age. So I had a lot going on and had a lot of experiences, you know, I had record deals on MTV, getting into youth work.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the latter part of my teens, I got into more kind of spirituality and looking at my purpose on earth and my purpose in my community and my purpose in my family. I returned back to youth work, but with more a kind of diversionary type mindset.
Okay.
And we can talk about that. And parallel to that, I started to go, I went and studied and studied as an adult education tutor.
Yeah.
And teacher. So you're talking now late 90s, okay? So late 90s, early 2000s, bang, you saw the increase in gang violence amongst within the UK.
Yeah, yeah.
So then I was a youth worker in the field, but I'd also had a teaching background. So I was teaching and I had my eye on youth work.
Yeah.
And then basically born out of that, I amalgamated both mindsets and started realizing that, well, youth work, that type of youth work, especially when you're dealing with issue-based youth work, it needs to, you need to create a model of transformation as opposed to diversion.
Yeah.
And that's where, hence, a lot of the work that you see me doing and things they mentioned in the introduction, what launched me to do that. So the idea is around those most at risk. Mm-hmm. We need to develop transformative strategies, not diversionary strategies. And so when I looked out onto the piece, there was a lot of you know, you've got, let's take them, let's do five-a-side football, let's do this, let's do that. But really, they're just stopgaps.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So I kind of, with all what I've experienced and the learning that I did, I said, no, we need to create transformative programs. Mm. And that's hence 10 plus years later, we're here today having this conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, well, I need to ask the questions that Team Toolbox want to ask. So one of the first ones is your music career. Don't give us too much detail. Just tell us a little bit more about that.
Well, you know, when people say they're old school, I'm from the era in terms of Public Enemy, Brand New Year. So at 17, I was, me and my friends, we're still friends to today, we were picked up by a record label. So we're a Birmingham-based crew.
Okay.
And there wasn't much, it's different. There wasn't much competition. Everyone was into ragga, but we was into hip-hop.
Yeah, yeah. What was the name of the crew?
I won't say it, man. I'm embarrassed by some of the pictures. Yeah. But maybe when I meet in person, yeah. But it's funny enough, 17, we got an offer to tour with Ice-T, Rhyme Syndicate at the time.
Yeah.
That was an eye-opener. Then just after that, we got signed. So we got a publishing deal. And then just after, we toured with people like Brand Nubian. And we brought a lot of artists over to the UK as well at that time.
Okay.
So we kind of, we were kids, essentially. When I look back at it, 17, I look at 17, 18-year-olds now, and I think, was I really doing that at 17 and 18? You know? And we were on a salary, and we were on, you know, we had our own studio. We were working with people, you know, we were doing well. But I think looking back, it's because there wasn't as much. Like now, every man and his dog wants to be an MC.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I mean, we never had YouTube and Facebook and all those times. It was like you had to get a video crew. And like you said, the only way you got it out was if you was on MTV, where nowadays anyone can shoot a music video on their mobile phone and send it around to the whole world.
Definitely.
But like, we don't want to spend too much time on that. Obviously, we'll talk further off, you know, when we're not recording. So that's where you came from. That's your background. So tell us a little bit more about your current work, the anti-youth violence and the gangology work.
Okay, so with as you know, with the increase in youth violence, gang-related youth violence across the UK, more and more I was getting contacted about coming and doing work with the young people. So I'd work in anywhere from schools, PRUs, YUS, and more recently, secure units.
Okay.
Now, So on that journey of working with thousands, I'm talking about access and exposure to thousands of young people every year, whether it be through assemblies, whether it be through one-on-one, whether it be through workshops. And I noticed the pattern, and the pattern would go something like this. Oh, Ray, thanks for coming. We've got a real big problem here with gangs. Our young people are wearing multicolored shoelaces.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, what? And so you've got head teachers calling you who are on probably 80 grand a year, not understanding the cultural competency of young people. That's youth culture. That's got nothing to do with gangs.
Yeah.
So that set kind of alarm bells for me. And I thought, we need some workforce development. We need to develop and engage practitioners in terms of their own personal development. Never, the young people are priority, yes, but how can we be effective practitioners if we are not upskilled? So mid-2000s, I launched Gangology, more or less.
Yeah.
It was almost written because I was invited to Northern Ireland to do some training around conflict resolution.
Yeah.
And like many of people, training for me is if it's not delivered by the right person, can be laborious.
Mm.
So but when I went there, I met a gentleman who delivered 3 to 4 day training on conflict resolution. And I went up to him at the end of the course and I said, can I have your flip chart paper? I really did. I felt like, I just felt like one of the, drop an apple on his desk and say, can I have you? Literally, this man changed the way I thought about conflict.
Wow.
But looking back on it, it was because we were in the epicenter of conflict.
Yeah.
So their understanding of it was real time. It wasn't a kind of something that they'd learned. This is something that they'd lived. He was a professor himself, but it made me understand as well about the importance of personal development, the importance of qualifying what we do, the importance of innovation and the importance of self-belief.
Mm.
So, yeah, that was it in terms of where we are today.
So I take it you gave you the flip charts.
Yeah, yeah. And if you didn't, I would have took it. Because, success leaves clues, Tony.
Yeah.
And I'm of mixed background, so Afro-Caribbean, Irish background.
Yeah.
So the flight was an hour from Belfast to Birmingham. And it was just on my mind in the flight thinking, that's just an hour away.
Yeah.
You know, and we like me myself and probably yourself, we grew up with those conflicts being in the media.
Yeah.
So I didn't realize how deep it went and how deep, and what's been done. So since there, I implemented some of the strategies that I learned and I've just grown wings. So I'll always be thankful for that experience. And I'd advise anyone who's into behavior management to visit there in the learning, put their learning hats on and go and visit there and understand the nature of conflict.
No, it's a very important lesson there as well. I mean, even just the boldness to ask the facilitator for his flip chart notes, it's a big lesson there. So Team Toolbox, if you ever go to a training session and you think that was valuable, go and ask a tutor for his flip chart notes. You never know, you might develop a whole company off the back of that. So
this is it. Gone are the days where you've got the guy, I believe, in terms of training and development,
yeah,
for many years, people have hid behind PowerPoints and handouts.
Mm.
And if anyone has ever been on my training, they don't get handouts and they don't get death by PowerPoint. And I'm serious.
Yeah.
And I wow people. And I wow people because I come from a school of thought that says training and development is a human-to-human experience.
Mm.
Whether you get sent by your manager or not, I'm giving you my energy and I'm taking your time.
Mm.
So whether I'm teaching you how to plant seeds or whether I'm teaching you about how to work with gangs, I'm giving you my 100 and I'm taking from you your time, which is precious. So if I don't leave you with that, I met this guy today or I met this lady today, and you know what? What they said there stuck with me and I'm going to implement that on Monday. If I don't leave you with that, then I'm selling you short as a practitioner.
Yeah. In terms of just digging a little bit more deeper, give us a basic overview of one of your workshops. So let's say, you've gone into a school and you're delivering to a group who've been identified as maybe at risk of involvement in youth violence. How would you wow them? How would you hit them?
Oh, with the young people. Okay. We ask the uncomfortable questions.
Mm.
So I will talk about the connection of father deficit and violent behaviour. You know, I will talk about urban ethnography with young people and we will map out why are you told in your school that you should achieve 5 A to C's, but the school 10 minutes up the road by car is told 10 A's. What's the difference?
Yeah.
I will talk about why is our community or your community, why are we surrounded by Dixie Chicken outlets and bookies and pubs? Why is it the norm? Does it have an effect on how you view the world? You know, we'll talk about relationships and how they view women. So it's what I'm trying to focus on is the drivers. I'm trying to focus on the cure, not the symptoms.
Yeah.
Okay. And if you dig deeper, like even into adults, for example, we know, you and yourself, we know adults that no matter what you advise them, they all, for example, in terms of partners, they always choose toxic relationships.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you think about that from an adult perspective, a lot of that is learned behavior. So some people fall in love with the idea of being in love, for example.
Mm-hmm.
All right. That's their goal, to fall in love. So they fall in love with the idea of it, not love itself. Likewise with young people, that are the most at-risk young people. I mean, I've worked in secure units, Tony,
mm-hmm.
and I'm seeing 11-year-olds in prison.
Mm.
11.
Yeah.
Now, what has happened between 0 and 10 for an 11-year-old to be in prison? And when you 99.9% of the time, it's parenting.
Yeah.
It's the exposure that young person's had, and they're the victim.
Yeah.
Okay? Do you know what I'm saying here?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I focus on the cure, not the symptom.
Mm.
So if I go into school and the problem is, you know, if I say to them, it's clear if a young person's not attending on time, or struggling to maintain energy throughout the day, we can take it right back to the Xbox to 3 a.m. It's simple.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If they're coming and beating up someone in school regularly, guess what? They're exposed to domestic violence at home.
Yes.
And it's just learned, you know, and this isn't hard, but there's an origin. If you want to lose weight, you eat less carbs, you exercise more.
Mm.
The pattern is there. There's nothing, as they said, a beautiful saying, there's nothing new under the sun. However, I think the culture is that if we need to, a lot of the time, the culture of a lot of youth intervention is firefighting.
Yeah.
And that's the problem.
Yeah, yeah. It reminds me of that saying, focus on the root, not the fruit. Because like you said, oftentimes a lot of the work, it's about, you know, hacking the fruit off the tree and dealing with the externals rather than, you know what, let's really delve deep and look at why is this young person doing this? Why are they expressing this behaviour and getting to the real root of the issue? And like you said, asking those uncomfortable and challenging questions.
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay, so that's the approach with the young people. What about with the staff? Because obviously, you know, when you're dealing with professionals, you've got to take a different approach. You know, we've been schooled, we've been educated, we've got our worldview kind of set. You know, oftentimes, I've spoke about it before in terms of that professional snobbery. I mean, I've got nothing against teachers and social workers, etc. But oftentimes when a youth worker comes in and says, right, I'm going to train you guys, that there's sometimes some resistance because there's a bit of professional snobbery. What's your approach?
I get to engage people from all different sectors. So in one of my training sessions, you'll have everyone from a probation officer, police, social services, education, social worker, voluntary sector, kind of community group, faith group. So you've got you're delivering to multi-agency.
Yeah.
So what I have to do is use a lot of emotional intelligence and bring us all down onto the same kind of field.
Yeah, yeah.
If I talk to you like based upon where you're a youth worker and you're a no. I use a lot of emotional intelligence in my work because I refer back to what I said about the human to human experience.
Mm.
So every one of those people in the room have been young people at some point.
Yeah.
So I take them back to that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're here now and you're professional and you're salaried and you've got commitments and you've got structure. Let's take it back 20 years.
Mm.
So that's an element of that, using emotional intelligence. Additionally, once again, I ask the hard questions. Now, I'm going to say something on here, and I make no apologies for it. Mm-hmm. A majority of people, since they've either graduated or got into youth work, well, whichever way they've got in, through experience or through qualifications, a majority of people, from my experience, have stopped reading. And the only time they read is when there's new legislation. I really believe that.
Yeah.
And what
Ray, I would say if that, you know, oftentimes, you know, I managed a local authority youth service for a number of years and we almost had to break it down and spell it out to them. This is what the new legislation is. So, sorry, I just wanted
to add that's fine.
So I agree. You know, personal development and youth workers, oftentimes it's almost, you know, you got to force it on them. And it's a big gripe. I need to get this off my chest. It's a big gripe of mine, because have you ever heard of anything like, you know, an organization is willing to pay for you to go on a full day train that's going to improve you. This training day is going to improve your practice. It's going to make you a better practitioner. And we're going to pay for you to go. And we're also going to pay you while you're there. We're going to pay you your full-time salary while you're there. And you're going to make up your face and complain, oh, my gosh, I've got to go on a full-day training today. My gosh. You know, and start complaining about it. I'm like, it's almost like spoiled brat syndrome. We're going to pay to make you better, and you're going to complain about it.
Well, let's do an exercise while we're on the phone now. You've got your pen on you, right?
Yeah.
Okay, for the listeners out there, grab a pen quickly. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, Tony,
yeah.
Apple, yeah?
Yeah.
Tell me, write down 5 things. When you think about the Apple store, the experience, write down 5 things now, quickly. Give me the first one.
Okay, clean.
Second one.
Innovative.
In terms of customer service, give me another one.
Customer service, I would say...
In terms of knowledge base.
They know the customer.
Okay. Fourth one, give me one more.
Their products are easy to use.
Okay. Five, and last one.
I would say you keep coming back for more.
Okay, excellent. Now, that's Apple, right? 5. Now, what I want you to write is PC World. Now, tell me about the experience at PC World.
Oh, man, don't ask me that question, Ray. Listen.
No, come on, give me 5. Come on. We've never met, have we?
Okay, PC World. You can easily get overlooked by a customer service rep.
Okay, secondly, what about product knowledge of the average member of staff?
Not great.
Okay, what about... people on the ground who can help you?
Oftentimes, they've got to go and find someone from another department who knows about that product.
Or the security guard showing you around, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. What about the aftercare? Exactly. You were going to say, what aftercare?
What aftercare? Okay. No, on a real, I bought my daughter a laptop for her birthday in December. Yeah. And I had the laptop for about 6 hours. It wouldn't work. I took it back. And a woman was asking me questions as though I'd stole the laptop. Exactly. I was like... I've got my receipt here.
Exactly.
You know. Go on. Make your point.
There you go. So this is what I say to practitioners: are you, as a youth practitioner, are you going to be Apple or are you going to be PC World?
Okay.
Because, and when you look at it, we've never met, have we?
No.
We've only spoken a couple of times offline,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So why is it your experience of Apple and my experience of Apple is exactly the same, and our experiences of PC World is exactly the same, and all of you out there listening, your experiences are the same? Mm-hmm. Because there's a culture within those organizations that is consistent. So likewise with us as youth practitioners, are you going to be Apple or are you going to be PC World?
Mm-hmm.
Because, and when you look at Apple, The thing that differentiates them from most people is that their R&D, their research and development budget, is the same as most people's manufacturing budget, their research and development.
Wow.
Which takes us back to our original conversation is, what are you reading?
Mm.
Where's your research and development? Because if you're not investing in yourself outside of your job description, then that will transpire into your practice. Simple.
Yeah. So... I mean, I can talk about this all day, Ray, you know.
Yeah.
Do you think that because a lot of youth work has been driven by local authority, and oftentimes youth practitioners haven't had to make a personal investment in themselves, do you think that's contributed to that mindset?
There's a beautiful saying that if you don't induct the young people into the village, they will burn it down to feel its warmth.
Wow.
And likewise, I see a lot of, and my experience, some great youth workers, but burnt out.
Mm.
And burnt out has come as a result of them being asked around the number of people they've engaged, not the quality of work that they've done.
Yeah.
So if you say, a youth centre could say, we worked with 300 young people in the last 2 quarters.
Yeah.
But what if 299 of them have got a drug habit?
Mm.
And for many years, there's been a case. And it's important because that's the world we live in. It's about numbers.
Mm.
But how can we measure the quality of the work? So if you've, this is what I'm saying, so how could you measure the quality of the work? And one of the things we said there about Apple is the aftercare.
Yeah.
Right? Aftercare is nuts, right?
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. You'll leave that place and you'll get an email in your inbox within 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Right? So what I'm saying is that, and I'm back to what I originally said, success leaves clues.
Mm.
And if you look at those, whether it be through the private sector, the public sector, the faith community, those who've always excelled, those who've always been, the things like innovation, what you mentioned,
yeah,
things about knowledge, if we can lift that and bring it into the youth space, yeah, and once you understand that, then you're going to see some serious warriors out there who are serious about youth work, serious about young people. And not to say that they aren't there, but a lot of them are burnt out.
Mm.
Just the physical energy I'm getting from you. We're caregivers, essentially.
Yeah.
So if you can't replenish your energy, that's going to be transferred to that young person.
Yeah.
So, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I'm just conscious. We're kind of 30 minutes into the interview and we're still on question one.
Okay.
But,
okay,
you know, it's a good one. I'm sure Team Toolbox are getting loads from this, you know, and I like those challenging discussions. It's all about, you know, like I said in the intro, it's about equipping one generation to serve the next, you know, and sometimes this is what people need to hear. They need that, you know, they need to have their feathers ruffled and to have that, you know, that kick up the backside to say, you know what, raise your game, invest in yourself, improve yourself, and, you know, just be willing to keep learning. It's so easy to just, yeah, like you said, get your qualification, get in the field, and that's it. Stop. And only go on a training session when your line manager sends you one. Right, quick question. Do you class yourself as a youth worker? And if so, or if not, why?
No, I class myself as someone who works with young people.
Okay. Go ahead.
Because I didn't come the conventional route.
Yeah.
You know, as I said, my amalgamation comes from being a tutor and having youth work experience. I do a lot more other things than being working with young people as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, because as I said, 70% of my work is worth with the youth practitioners. And I think now it's a bit, the lines are blurred, mm-hmm, in terms of youth work and you working with young people. They're very blurred. I think it's something that we need to revisit. The difficulty is that youth work, and I'll tell you why I won't call myself a youth worker, because I don't think the leadership in youth work has fought hard enough to make it a statutory requirement within local authority. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
And because youth work is not statutory, it's people are able to slap it about and move it about and bully it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get what I mean? So
yeah, yeah.
If we, for example, had set up our shop like libraries who are statutory,
yeah,
then you wouldn't see the problems you see with youth intervention now. So I've, as you can hear, like I'm from your neck of the woods, I'm from Birmingham.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you look at some of the opportunities now here for youth in Birmingham, you would be shocked. As the biggest local authority in Europe,
yeah,
and historically the largest youth service in Europe.
Yeah.
So you're in an era where 18 youth centres have closed down.
Yeah.
And in high risk areas, mm-hmm, you're not talking about in affluent gravel drive areas. We're talking about high risk areas of deprivation. So that term youth worker, it's blurred, mm, for me personally, and I'm happy to be challenged on that,
mm,
because I think if we were youth workers, then we'd have a statutory requirement bolted onto us.
Yeah.
Just like social workers, just like probation officers,
yeah,
just like, you know, who politically are very strong.
Mm.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. No, I hear that. I hear that. I had a similar discussion with Matt Lent on a previous podcast, and it's the same thing we were talking about. You know, just the lack of legislation, the lack of, you know, policy related to youth work. It's just allowed it to be, like you said, bullied and pushed around, and, you know, it's kind of like it can be interpreted how anybody wants to interpret it. You know, our youth service is delivered by, you know, the local Brownies group down the road, and that ticks the box. So,
yeah, it ticks the box until the whole country riots.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You get what I mean? So,
and then there's some new police legislation.
Of course.
So,
of
some
course.
new I enforcement.
Mean, or you have police doing youth work.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. You have police working with young people. I know there are some great police out there who do some great work with young people. I don't want to try and kind of, you know, disregard what they do. But I think where we are now is we're in an era now where So you're getting the localized youth work coming online. And if you don't have a local councillor or a chief exec of a local authority who has a real desire to work with young people, who has a real passion about it and sees the power of it and the significance of it, then once again, you're going to see youth workers as these tracksuit and or trainers and jeans type characters who've got a qualification, but can you go over there and work in there with those young people and just getting sent over there and sent over there? And that's the challenge that youth work has now.
It's a good segue to the next point. You know, we've kind of touched on it in terms of the youth sector changing, the landscape changing. From your perspective, what do you think it will look like in the next 5 years? Or what would you like it to look like in the next 5 years?
Okay, what it will look like in the next 5 years.
Yeah.
The way it's going, you're going to have it just the way that the criminal justice system's going. You're going to have privatization.
Yeah.
So you've got private companies who open prisons now.
Yeah.
Why do they open prisons? Is it because you get £38,000 per year per inmate? And if it's Cat A, you get £48,000 a year. So it's a serious business.
It sure is, yeah.
Yeah, which was still saving. You're still saving what it costs the taxpayer. Secondly, but you're starting to see it now. You're seeing private companies come into the youth workspace.
Yeah.
You know, slowly but surely. So if there's not a political will to keep youth work the way it historically was, then you will start seeing commissioning. Now, commissioning, the way that's going, and it's starting to happen already. But if you've got a big company, a national organisation, who have got large reserves, and then they can bid in for commissioning, because they've got large reserves, then they can recoup at the end of the programme. Small local organisations can't do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you know, so you're kind of going to get the gentrification of youth work now.
Yeah.
How I'd like to see it, I would like to see organisations have a social enterprise arm that allows them to trade.
Yeah.
So they can sustain themselves. That's what I believe. So if you've got a youth centre and it's big enough, put a baguette shop in there and a coffee shop. If you've got a space that you can use, create a media company that income generates to support your youth work. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, forget. I've said to people, and I'm sure you'll tip your hat to this, Tony. Stop doing projects. Make products.
Yeah.
Projects have only got a 9-month lifespan.
Yeah.
Even if the chief exec's your best friend, even if you're so close to the pot that you can feel the heat off it. The world's changing every year. Someone might be your chief exec now who believes in youth work today, and then he leaves to be the head of housing of some corporation tomorrow, or she, and you're back to square one.
Yeah.
But if you've got a sustainable strategy within your organisation, then you can trade. If you can trade, then you can income generate, you can employ, you can stay above water.
I agree, definitely. I mean, when I set up Youth Work Toolbox, one of my ambitious goals was to not be dependent on funding bids. You know, a lot of people that I've sort of spoken to in the past, a lot of people that I've seen set up their own projects, they've been dependent on chasing funding. And I've literally seen them do that, chase funding. So wherever the funding is, whatever, you know, the latest pot of funding is available, they will change their whole business model, their whole delivery model to attract that funding. And I said to myself, that's not what I want. I want to develop a business model where we can become financially viable. We can offer services and products. So, you know, you've probably seen on the website, you know, there's products I've developed that I'm selling to local authorities, and it's not a service. It's not a project. This is a product.
Exactly. Someone said that you're early. What's it called? The early mate.
Early help mate.
Great. I was watching it earlier. Great stuff.
And
the thing is, that's your dent in the universe as well. So, you know, it's not just the case of products, but it's the social return on the products. And if you speak to a lot of practitioners about, well, tell me about your social return on investment. They're looking at you like, what are you on about, right?
Yeah.
So that there goes back to our thing about personal development. Know your worth.
Yeah.
You know, you're doing great work as a youth worker. Know, you know, quantify it and find out. Well, hold on. So, for example, with myself, One shooting, Tony, cost you and me, the taxpayer, £1.4 million.
Wow.
One shooting. A stabbing cost £300,000.
Wow.
So if I'm working with at-risk young people who are at risk of, quote-unquote, in the vernacular, bossing their gun, and I can prevent that, what am I saving the taxpayer?
Yeah, yeah.
So,
what's the cost of a shooting, did you say?
About £1.4 million.
£1.4 million per shooting. And
yeah, so that's
and they want to give practitioners like
five, ten grand
to do a 12-week program with some high risk, you know, young people, and that's one shooting. It's ridiculous. It's crazy.
And the reason why is, just as a side point, the reason why is because youth violence is not seen as youth violence is essentially seen as a criminal justice issue, which it partly is.
Yeah.
But if you look at all the drivers, it's a public health issue.
Yeah.
So unless we address it like a public health issue, you will always get that, oh, can you take them on a residential kind of mindset? But they're still going back to the block of flats with the crack dealers outside and the lift's broke. And when it's working, there's urine in the lift and mum's holding down two jobs and there's three other siblings and, you know, all the other scenarios.
Yeah,
that's how I see it. If you can, in the next 5 years, have a sustainable strategy.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what, Ray, I'm sure you'll agree, a lot of youth workers, in terms of their creative ability, their, you know, the ability to kind of just see something and to create a program, if they just changed that mindset and created a product, how many products there'd be on the market that people could buy into and that could, like you said, have a social return on investment. You know, they've got the ability to do it. They've got the skills to do it.
Exactly. You see, there's a problem here, though. But there's no way you can say to me that you studied 3 years at university, all right? 3 years. Someone studied 3 years at university, went through, lost sleep, financially put themselves under pressure, all the things that they did, stressed themselves out, got this certificate. And after 3 years, you cannot develop a product on sexual health. You have to outsource it. You cannot develop a product on race and identity. You have to outsource it. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. But it's mindset and it's culture, though, isn't it? You know, if all you know is that you're going to go and work for a local authority or go and work for an organisation, and as the issues come up, you just develop a project and you deliver that project. It's the mindset. See it as a product that you can, you can build on it, you can reshape it, you can sell it. And it's not just about making money. Do you get what I'm saying? Some people would hear that and think, well, these guys just are into making money. It's about creating a viable stream of income that you can continue to deliver quality work to young people.
People say that, but how do you sustain the message then? If you've got a pandemic of diabetes in your community, or if you've got gun crime, or if you've got teenage pregnancy, if you can only deliver when you get the funding, how do you sustain the message? How do you make a reduction in that pandemic? You can't. Yeah. So if you sustain the message, then you can keep the message afloat. And this is the thing that people don't, you know, if you look at historically, any social impact campaign has to have three fundamental tenets to it. Firstly, there has to be a clarion call, so something that everyone sits up and says, we need to do something about this. Secondly, so if you look at civil rights or versus the 99% scenario or finding Kony, so the clarion call went up. Civil rights, it was Rosa Parks. The 99% was the banks. Finding Kony was the viral video, right?
Yeah.
When 26 million hits in a day. Secondly, the leadership has to be defined.
Yeah.
Right? So if you look at civil rights, you can name them all day. Stokely Carmichael, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and all the tens of hundreds of white civil rights activists that were out there.
Yeah.
99%, there was no leadership.
Yeah.
Finding Kony, the guy got sectioned within 2 weeks of the video going viral.
Wow.
So the leadership flawed. Thirdly, the end game has to be correct. So the end game in civil rights was they wanted to change the constitution. The 99%, what was the end game? No one knew. Finding Kony, they wanted to find him. He's still out there. Do you get what I'm saying? So if I'm saying we've got a teenage pregnancy problem in our community, that's the clarion call. What does it look like, though, the reduction? So who's the leadership? Where's it going to come from on this?
Yeah.
That's my point. So people can say, oh, you're about money. Yes, of course. Of course. There's a social return on investment.
Yeah.
You know, there's nothing wrong with having a conversation about that.
Yeah.
But don't try and kind of, you know, if you think booking a coach and taking some young people away for a day, if you think that's the youth work of 2014, you're in the wrong sector.
Mm.
That's a small part of it, and it's valuable. But we're in a society now where I'm seeing 11-year-olds in prison, Tony, on attempted murder charges.
Yeah. It's crazy. Yeah. Wow. No, it's really valuable. Really valuable. We need to move on.
Yeah.
I mean, we've touched on a lot of different things. From your perspective, just give us a quick overview of what you think makes a great youth worker.
Leading beyond permission.
Okay.
When I mean leading beyond permission, not going against the kind of hierarchy, but just cracking on.
Yeah.
You know, also revisiting learning. And that's really important. Mm-hmm. If you'd studied IT in 2003 and you graduated, 2005, you didn't do a module on wireless technology.
Yeah.
So likewise, if you're a youth worker who graduated 10 years ago, you did not do a module on gang intervention.
Yeah.
You didn't do a module on extremism or right-wing extremism. You didn't. So unless the only unless the only time you can revisit learning is that one-day course, how are you, steel sharpens steel. So how are you staying sharp and abreast of it?
Yeah.
And also, this is the third one for me, finally, specialise.
Yeah.
What is your thing? What is your thing? You know?
Yeah.
And this is the key thing. You like, you know about niching. That's why we're having this podcast today.
Yeah.
And that's what I say to a youth worker. What is your speciality in the police? They have speciality. In the kitchens, they have specialists.
Mm.
In the football, on the football field, they don't put a right winger left midfield.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Or if they do, they only do it to change tactics. They don't put your striker in goals. So what's your speciality? And how can we help you? And how can you help yourself develop in that area?
Yeah. I think that's something that stuck with me on a previous conversation we had, is that willingness to go deep. You know, and oftentimes there's not that willingness to say, you know what, I want to master this. I want to get mastery of this topic or this area. And I'm willing to go deep. I'm willing to not just put a little 6-week program together. I'm looking to really learn about it, understand it, break it down, look at the history of it, you know, and see what other people are doing in other countries, and really just have that willingness to go deeper. And again, I think a lot of youth workers that I've worked with in the past, you know, they're great at doing a lot of, no, they're good at doing a lot of things, but they're not great at doing any specific thing. So
definitely,
I agree. I hear that. So what I want you to do, Ray, just tell us about a time when you experienced or witnessed great youth work, either as a practitioner or as a young person yourself.
I see it all the day, every day. But something that stands out, I would say a youth centre was going to get closed down not far from me when I was young.
Yeah.
And in the end, it did get closed down. But the fight that I saw them youth workers put up for it,
mm-hmm.
and the drivers for the fight as well,
yeah.
they went hard. And they went hard because, and now when I look back at it, the resource that was lost was a phenomenal resource.
Mm.
But so that's the example for me, is that fight. And I really think, and I don't want to go too deep into it because it opens a few wounds for a lot of people.
Mm.
I really believe that we didn't fight properly with these last rounds of youth cuts. I don't believe we did. Mm. You know, and some people, individuals did.
Yeah.
But to the level, you would not have 18 midwives being removed from your community. So why have 18 youth centres?
Yeah.
And so it goes back. So that's the thing I'm saying. I've witnessed people fighting for their cause,
mm-hmm.
and not just accepting it.
Yeah. No, I hear that. And I know a lot of people are, as we speak, they're still trying to rally up some backative to continue to fight for their services. Okay, so a lot of our listeners, those that engage with the show, a lot of them are up and coming. You know, they're either studying at the moment or they've just got into the field and they're, you know, really kind of finding their way. What advice would you give to an aspiring youth worker just starting out?
Specialise.
Yeah.
And what I said, you know, Malcolm Gladwell talks about it a lot. He talks about, are you a big fish in a small pond or a small fish in a big pond?
Mm.
It's better that you're a big fish in a small pond. Evidence leads towards that.
Yeah.
If you're a go-to person in some specific area, people will come to you. But if you're just a generic, you're kind of just like, you know, along going with the flow, you won't stand out. We need youth workers who stand out now. So if you look at anyone that I'm connected to, whether I've mentored them or they've mentored me, They're people who stand out. They're people. There's got to be a reason why, Tony, you clicked on me in Twitter or whatever, however we connected.
Yeah.
Or our paths crossed. It's not because I'm a great youth worker. It's not because I'm the best youth worker. It's because I stand out. Mm. And I don't make no apologies for standing out. And this is the thing. So get specialized, focus on your message mastery as well. How do you get your message out there? And also, thirdly, define your purpose and your passion.
Yeah.
If your passion, if your purpose is to get a salary, then get a salary. That's not a problem. But if your passion is something, then amalgamate. If your passion is about whatever that is, then amalgamate, whether it's dance, whether it's business, whether it's enterprise, whether it's race and equality, just get your message out there. And that's all I'd say. So be a big fish in a small pond. Do not be a little fish in a big pond.
Yeah, definitely some great advice there. So, I mean, we spoke a little bit about, you know, about the changes, etc. And we both know, you know, we're making best use of technology now. There's some huge advancements in internet technology. How do you think youth workers can make better use of the ongoing advancements in internet technology?
I use the 70-20-10 strategy with my social media. Yes. 70% is my core message. 20% is current affairs. And 10% is random type stuff.
Yeah.
So everything I do has a strategy to it. I don't know, if I take a picture of my jerk chicken, rice and peas,
yeah,
I'm going to connect and I put it on Instagram. I'm going to say to you, a youth worker needs to put fuel in the tank. You're going to have some reality. It's going to be connected to my core message. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So you know, I'm not going to be on, I'm not, and this is, everyone can be assured of this. I'm not going to be on Facebook pouting. Do you know what I mean? I haven't got time for that. But what I'm saying is embrace social media.
Yeah.
And I don't think a grown man like me should be pouting anyway. But if you're going to embrace social media,
yeah
I want to know who, I do want to know who you are.
Yeah.
But if your thing is quote unquote rabbits, I don't want to see 99% of pictures of rabbits.
Yeah.
You know, just give it me, bring it down a bit, take it down to 70. Let me find out who's that person behind that handle.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, you're not like yourself. I've been out to Silicon Valley and I studied with Brendan Burchard. I've been to live events with Seth Godin.
Yeah.
You know, I'm Malcolm Gladwell out, you know.
Yeah.
Because these are people who, for me, and this is probably what made me different from the most of the people in the gang intervention space. I read gang's books, but I went the other way as well. And to find out, well, how do I maximize impact within my work?
Yeah.
And that helped me. So that's what I would say is embrace social media, but stop the pouting and let me know who you are and get your message out there. And that's all I'll say.
Yeah, yeah. So you said 70-20-10, so that was 70% core message.
Yeah.
20% current affairs. Okay, and 10% random.
10% random, just anything. Just
jerk chicken.
That's cool. But if I'm saying... If you're just showing me there's one dimension to yourself,
then
I'm not going to stand. You're not going to stand out.
Yeah.
So, you know, let me know who you are, but keep me at bay as well. Yeah. Let me hear your message, but at the same time, don't kill me with it.
Yeah, yeah. No, I hear that. Very good advice. I mean, we mentioned, obviously, on the point of technology, what tech tools are you using currently that's really helping you in your practice?
The main platforms, obviously, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, web. Is still good. I'm about to embrace a whole new element of it though. So I'm going to be, and you're the first to hear this, I'm going to be going live with a lot of my stuff, but not live as in kind of the camera in front of me talking. A mixture of connecting with people who are, and I'll probably come knock on your door, to be honest, or your virtual door, who are just doing things different. I can see the bin man turn up and I can get so much knowledge out of a bin man and turn it into product. Does that make sense? So I can say to him, what makes a great bin man?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Because there are good bin men and there are bad bin men.
Yeah.
So likewise, I could speak to a doctor, I could speak to a footballer, I could speak to the lollipop lady or lollipop man or whoever they are and there's so much learning out there and things you can get from the average person. So that's where I'm going with it now. I want to know, okay, you're here, but how did you get here? So that's my new kind of thing I'm taking and I'm going to be working on that. I was actually doing some stuff on it this week because I said, you know, I do specialize in what I do, but I'm really, 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 I love understanding the human experience.
Yeah.
You know, I really like, you know, Yuri Gagarin lived in a mud hut for 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
But he was the first man to orbit Earth.
Wow.
There you go. So when a man says to me, blood, man's from the ends, you know, I can't get out. I'm like, bro, go on Wiki, P Wikipedia and read about Yuri Gagarin.
Yeah.
Read how he was in a mud hut in the end and he ended up orbiting Earth.
Wow.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it just reminded me of my interview with Errol Lawson, and he's obviously got a book called From the Postcode to the Globe.
Yeah, man, shout out to Errol.
Yeah, man, it's the same kind of message. On that note, before we move on to the quickfire round, tell us a bit about these two books you're authoring.
Okay, first book is, when I went to America, I was on the plane from Dallas to San Jose, and I was thinking London to New York takes about 6-7 hours. LA to New York takes about 6-7 hours. So really, the Biggie versus Tupac thing was, it was a fallacy, because nobody's going to jump on their plane and punch someone in their face and jump and fly 6 hours back. But if you look at the effect it had on young people, especially in our communities, they took a model of conflict, their man versus us man, this postcode versus that postcode, territorialism, etc. So I started drafting the book and talking about, it's called Gang's Kitchen, basically, which is recipes to resolve gang violence. So it's a satire element to it, but it's a serious message in the sense that, so I break it down, whether it be from parenting right through to youth offending, right through to prison. And then the second one is called Murder Media, the effects of music, films and video games on young people and violence.
Okay.
Because I really believe that you can map the increase in violence connected to the increase in exposure to violence via media.
Mm.
So those are my two books, and they should be out by the end of the year.
Okay. Definitely. I mean, we'll try and get you back on to promote those when they're ready to go. So that's Murder Media and
Gang's Kitchen.
Gang's Kitchen. Okay, yeah, looking forward to those. Excellent. Okay, we need to move on to my favourite part of the show. So this is a quick fire round. So the way it works, Ray, is I'm going to give you 10 questions. You've got, multiple choice. You've got two choices and you can only pick one.
Yeah.
No deliberating. You can't phone a friend. You know, no deferring. Just answer the question. So
cool. You
ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's go. Universal or targeted?
Targeted.
Center-based or detached?
Detached.
Planned or improvised?
Planned.
Digital or analog?
Digital.
Flip chart and pens or laptops and tablets?
Flip chart and pens.
Statutory or voluntary?
Statutory.
Localized or centralized?
Centralized.
Policy or practice?
Practice.
Group work or one-to-one?
Group work.
And finally, hard copy or audiobook?
Audiobook.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Thanks, Ray.
Respect.
Okay, so it's been a real valuable interview. We've gone long, which is good. I like it when we go long. Gives team toolbox a lot of valuable content, a lot to take away, a lot to think about. And, you know, I'm sure they've got a lot to take away from this. But before we close out, what I want you to do, Ray, is to just leave us with one piece of parting advice or guidance, and then tell us where's the best place to find you online.
Yeah. Cool. Finding me online, firstly, you can catch me on @Gangology on Twitter. That's always the easiest one. GangOlOgy. And my parting advice is, out of the 4 million sperm eggs, there's got to be a reason why you were the one who are here today.
Mm.
So there's 3 million plus that never made it. And there's got to be a purpose why you're sat here and I'm sat here and people are listening, are sat there. Your time here is short.
Mm.
And very, very short, you know, and if you can harness your purpose, have your job and buy your house and whatever, travel the world. But in the middle of all of that, if you haven't achieved your purpose, then you're going to be empty. So I would say is that define your purpose, embrace life, embrace young people, you know, and that that there will leave to legacy, because that's the thing. Or the people who, whether you agree with them or not, the people who founded Cub Scouts and Brownies and all these youth organizations, they're no longer here, but they left a legacy. The people who our parents, I'm from an Afro-Caribbean background, and I said this yesterday, I was on an interview yesterday, a lot of our parents who came from the diaspora, they came with a suitcase and an address and then built something, and the legacy that they created was for us.
Yeah.
when people say, oh, it's hard out here, you know, and, you know, and that's just girls with deep voices like that, or, you know, or, you know, someone says to me, you don't fall for that self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah.
You know, you're here for a purpose. I'm here for a purpose. Let's find out what it is if you don't know it already and just fly. And once you get those wings, you know, you're going to soar. Mm. And I guarantee that. So, but I'd like to say thank you for inviting me, Tony.
No, you're welcome.
I hope there's a lot on what I said on the podcast that people disagree with, because that's the only way that we can create dialogue and make a difference, you know. So,
yeah.
So you know, I don't have all the answers. I just gave you how Ray Douglas views the world.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what? If you do disagree, then, you know, the comment sections below is open and let's have that dialogue. You know, that's what it's about.
Definitely.
So, Ray Douglas, thank you. Team Toolbox, we salute you. You know, you've shared a lot of great value, a lot of real solid points for us to really think about. And I think the key one for me is to specialise. You know, that's a key thing that's come out for me. And I think a lot of the listeners will go away and really ponder that and dig a bit deeper. So thank you. We salute you. And we look forward to speaking to you again soon.
Okay. Peace. Thanks for the invite.
All right.
All the best.
All right. Take care.
Bye.
So there you have it, Team Toolbox. Like I said, another great interview. And if you take nothing else away from that, the key message for me and the key message for you really is to specialise. That's what really stood out for me, is to find yourself a specialism and really go deep on it. And this will help you to stand out from the crowd. So that's it for this episode. Thanks again for joining us. And I look forward to having you join us again on the next episode of Youth Work Toolbox. If you haven't already done so, go over to the Facebook page, facebook.com/youthworktoolbox, and say hi, leave us a comment, and join the conversation. So until the next episode, God bless and take care.
Thanks, Team Toolbox. We appreciate your support. Let's keep the conversation going on Twitter and Facebook. In the meantime, those young people need you. So go and give them the best you got.